New Hanover County Senior Resource Center presents Living Legacy, a collection of personal stories from our seniors. Through autobiographical storytelling, we can learn more about years past and present as we move to the future. We hope you enjoy.
My name is Carolyn B. James.
And Carolyn, do you know why your parents selected your name?
Well, my mom had selected Janet, but the midwife, she gave me Carolyn, and she put that on the birth certificate. And when my mom found out, I was like maybe 10 years old. So we had to change from Janet to Carolyn. So by that time, it was okay. Carolyn, that sounds good.
Good. Carolyn's a pretty name. So did you have a nickname growing up?
I am a twin. Oh. And which I am the oldest. And my brother, Kenneth. So my mom told me when we were little, when we couldn't call each other names, I told him I was girl and he was boy. So we called each other girl and boy until we got about 10. Then we started trying to, you know, because when our friends would come around, I did not want him to call me girl. And when his friend was around, he didn't want me to call him boy.
So neat. That's a neat story. Where were you born?
I was born in King Street, South Carolina. That's an hour away from Charleston.
Okay. If you don't mind me asking, how old are you?
I'm 60. Okay. 60 years old.
And what year is that?
December the 27th. Mm-hmm. I just turned 60 last year.
Happy belated birthday. Yes, big milestone, huh?
Yes.
So how did your family get to where you grew up at in South Carolina? Was that where they were from?
Yes. Both of them was born and raised in South Carolina. Yes. Yes, but yeah, because my granddaddy, yes. Their tis their soul and born, so they was born and raised there in South Carolina.
Did you grow up in South Carolina your whole childhood?
Yes. I left there when I was 18 years old. Mm-hmm. Okay, yes. I was born and raised in King Street. Yes.
And you said you have a twin brother. Yes. Do you have other siblings?
Yes. My parents total was 12 kids.
Wow.
And one of my brothers died before my twin and I. He was a toddler. And after mama had us, then I had another brother and he died when he was a baby. So it left 10 of us.
Okay. So you and your brother are
In the second set.
Okay.
You know, because the first set was my older siblings, and when they got up, my father used to share crop back then. So really, you know, you couldn't hire people because you didn't have the money, especially when you were sharecropping. So back then they was having big families to take care of the farm and to help on the farm.
Did you work on the farm?
By the time I turned 8, my dad had decided to build a house and move out because, well, when you share crop, you don't pay monthly. You pay like one time, that's coming up like the end of the fall, and that could be like $200 to $300. So after you have gather up all the crop, the tobacco and the cotton, soybeans and the corn, then you start paying off your bills. Like if you have credit at stores, if you purchase a mule, you know, you have to pay your debts. So really you get, when you harvest, and then when you gotta pay, you know, this a one-time thing every year. And so by each year, she decided that she was going to go up to 350, and daddy said, we can't afford that. So that's when he started looking for another job, and he found a good job.
Good. Yeah. What type of crop did?
My daddy, well, you know, God is good, because anything and everything my father hand touched, it was beautiful. So he planted tobacco, planted cotton, corn, and his crop was beautiful. I mean, even though if you didn't know what tobacco, you know, and the tobacco was so beautiful and green, and they had the little flowers up on top of it, which they had to suck it. But anything my father hand touched, and by living on a farm, he would like have an acre of garden, and we would have to get up early in the morning, like 5 o'clock in the morning, when the dew is still on, to pick the beans and gather the tomatoes and cucumbers, and you know, because we really, by farming, there's very little that you had to buy going to the store. So we really didn't have to go to the store. Other time my mother had to go to the store was to get sugar. Other than that, everything else we ate off the farm.
It was the true meaning of organic.
Yes. Yes, what y'all would call now.
Yes. Yep. What's your earliest childhood memory?
Earliest childhood memory is when I was 5 years old. And in between taking care of us, cleaning the house and cooking, my mother would sew. Because back then you would get beautiful feed sacks. And when daddy would feed the hogs and everything, and he would give her the sacks, and the real cotton. I mean, 100% cotton. And she would wash them, and then she would make our clothes. So I would sit there for, you know, hours and watching her sew, and I wanted to sew, but she always would say, no, I can't give you a needle because you're going to pick your hand, and you know you can't use the scissors. So I used to watch her, and I said, well, Mama, how old I got to be before I can use a needle and thread? She said, you have to wait until you turn 8 years old. That was 3 years. I was like, wow. But I sat there watching her, and boy, when I turned 8, it was like, it was even better than Christmas. And when she gave me that needle and thread, she gave me some scraps. And I started sewing. And one little girl had got a Barbie doll. Back then, you could get them at the dime store for a dollar. And they didn't come with clothes. And she showed us her doll, and she said, I want to change her clothes. And I said, I can make you some clothes. And so what I did, I would let my mama cut up me a straight piece of material. And then she would fold and cut a hole in the center. And then I would sew up the little two sides and leave a part where you can put the arm in and the head. And I charged 10 cents. And she said, oh, I like this. So she said, can you make me some more? I said, yeah. So how much is your doll? She said, $1. So I said, okay. So I made her 10 outfits, and my sister had wanted a Barbie doll. So I took the dollar, and my mom and daddy went to the downtown, and we went to the 10-cent dime store. I let my sister buy her a Barbie doll with it.
Oh, what a giving heart.
Well, I was getting a lot of it because I was sewing. I didn't mind, you know, my sister playing with a doll because, you know, I wasn't all into dolls, but the needle and thread, that was my joy.
Do you still sew today?
I still do some. I don't do as much, but I'm quilting some of my mother's quilts.
Mm. Very nice. What type of games did you play when you were growing up?
I would watch my brothers and sisters outside. I really didn't go outside. I stayed inside the house due to I was older than the others, and I helped keep the house clean, but yet my spare time, I sewed. Okay.
Do you remember what type of games your brothers and sisters would
play?
Oh,
they would play softball. They would ride the bikes around in the backyard. They would play tag, hide and seek. That's about it.
So most of the games
yes.
were outside. The
yes.
kids were active. And
oh, yes. Yes, yeah. Yes. No, all the time you would watch TV is like 7 o'clock when you come in at night after supper. Then you watch TV maybe for an hour or two, and then you go to bed.
What were your favorite songs and type of music when you were growing up?
When my dad was at work, I used to love to listen to the blues, Gladys Knight and the Pips, soul music. When my daddy was home, it had to be gospel. So.
Did they know you were listening to the
Well,
kind of
mom,
blues?
Did. Okay. Mom did. Mom did.
But your dad didn't know.
No, because see, we knew what time he would get off from work. So we had to change the channel and close the blinds and go outside.
What type of show would you watch?
Oh, back then it was J.J. Evans, Good Time. Let me see what else. It wasn't too many, but mostly my mother would watch the soap operas like God in Light, Edge of Night, those during the day. And Soul Train would come on Saturday.
Who were your childhood heroes?
Martin Luther King, Kennedy family, really. And those two families was really mine and a lot of blacks. It was all.
Do you remember the day of Martin Luther King's?
Yes, it was like yesterday. I was like, I think I was 8 years old, going into 9. And it was afternoon, and we was outside. And I was outside sitting on the picnic table watching them, my brothers and sisters playing baseball. And mama had the TV on. And I saw my aunt came running across the yard. And she looked like she was sad. And she went in the house, and then mom called dad, and then went inside. I knew something was going on, but I didn't know what, and I knew it wasn't good. When I finally went inside, they was watching the TV, and I saw when the blacks was upset, and they was throwing bottles and everything in the windows. They were just destroying the stores, like they didn't care, you know. It's like, someone had took their joy away. And I stood there and I watched that TV and I saw the anger and the bitter and the hate. And I saw my aunt was crying. And I saw my mama was holding her. And my aunt was asking mama, what are we gonna do? What's gonna happen? And mama looked at her and said, we got Jesus. And when she said that, all of my fear had left. And I wasn't angry, but I was disappointed. But I said, yeah, I gotta remember, you know. Yeah. And I went back outside. And I just sat there and just thought about what I had just saw. And at the end of that, I remember what my mom said. So that helped me a lot.
Do you remember the day of President Kennedy's assassination?
Yes. My mom, she cried. She really did. She cried when every one of them got assassinated. She, you know, it was like, okay, we have lost one, but we still have another. And then when both Kennedys were assassinated, my mom didn't say anything. She went and she sat at the sewing machine. She just started sewing. I was waiting for the uplifting, like she did with Martin Luther King. But she didn't say nothing. She just sewed. All that day she sewed, and I sat in my little red rocking chair, and I watched her. And we didn't say nothing.
Probably this question most likely leads into this, but you might have a different answer. What world events have had the most impact on you growing up?
Well, when King and the Kennedys was taken from us, well, my granddaddy would say snatched from us. We just kind of fall there, you know? My daddy always used to tell us to take one step at a time. Make sure the right is in front of the left. And it took me a long time to realize what he meant by that. Mm-hmm. And then when Obama, and God allowed Mama and Daddy to live, to see him become a president. It was like, you know, when a cloud is drifting, it just hovers over you. But when he became president, the sun came back. And it was good. So it was Obama and his family.
Did any of those events that you've talked about, did any of them personally affect your family?
The sadness, the focus on surviving, keeping one foot in front of the other. Other than that, I mean, you have to understand, he was taught that, and this came from my father, we didn't have time to worry about what's going to come tomorrow. We had to focus on what is here at hand. And Daddy used to always constantly tell us that, focus on what's right now. Tomorrow will take care of itself. Yesterday is dead and gone. So focus on now. So really, even though we were sad that things took place and how integration of schools changed a lot of our life, we still had to live. You know, Mama always said, the milk is spilled, dry it up, move on. So we had to do that. And that really made us who we are today. You know, hugs and kisses are fine and good, but Mom and Dad knew that we needed more because they wasn't going to be around. And they needed to know that we could survive. And if we can deal with what's at hand now, then they won't worry as much when their time to leave us. So it wasn't all bad.
They gave some really good advice.
Yes.
In your opinion, how is the world different from what it was like when you were a child?
Oh, what I was like, oh my goodness. Back then, kids was outside playing. Everybody knew everybody. On Sundays, we would have gatherings. We'd go down to my granddad's house and cousins from all over would come, and we would play on the granddaddy porch and listen to them tell stories. And then when they would cry, we would cry. When they laughed, we laughed. And we drank lots of Kool-Aid back then with our legs planted in the cool sand on the granddaddy house. I mean, now people don't have time to even speak to. They don't even get to know their neighbors. Back then, what my family ate, my neighbor ate, you know. And But now, people don't have time for each other. They don't have time to sit down at the table and eat. They don't even have time for a hot meal. It's always fast food. Back then, you cooked. And you cooked 3-course full meal. That was breakfast, it was dinner, and that was supper. Here you have breakfast, lunch. You might have dinner, and you might not. So, yes, big difference. Big difference.
How was schools different from when you grew up to what you see today?
Well, when I first started school, I was at a black school. And all your cousins, your aunts, your grandparents was at that school. So you couldn't do too much bad, you know, because everybody knew everybody. And when the teachers, when they looked at you, that's all they had to do, because they knew your family. And they knew if they, oh my God, you know, who? You would got a whipping from them, and then you would get a whipping at home. So no, it was family. It really wasn't a school, it was family. And then when they integrated the school, I was in the second grade going to third grade. And it was like someone had pulled a rug from under you. And I fell and I fell and I kept falling for so long. Because in King Street, you had your white area, you had your black area. And going to a white school, it really, and you really didn't want to tell your parents how you was being treated, because they was already scared. But then Mama would always exhale every afternoon when she would see all of us get off the bus. And she would cry when we would get on that bus. But she never once let us see her cry, but we knew she cried. That first year. And I don't fault them, because we was made to go to their school and they was made to go to ours. So I didn't fault the white, because they was just as scared as we were. But it did. It devastated a lot of worlds, a lot of dreams, a lot of hopes. Killed a lot of memories. It slow walk us down to a point. Some got lost. I knew I did. Yes, I did. I hid myself. I made my own world. Because going through third grade, all the way up to 12th grade, they just pass you, you know. They didn't try. By the time I got to sixth grade, I didn't know how to read. So I was like quarterly, just getting Fs all the way through. I got a certificate stating that I had went to school for 12 years. I still have that certificate. No diploma, but a certificate.
So when you got your certificate, did you know how to read at that point?
The second grade.
Okay, second grade level.
Second grade.
So I want you to share your story, which is a true inspiration to me, about your journey to learning how to read.
Oh, K-Field Literacy. Okay, I came here 13 years ago. And the first year, it was 02. coming up to the end, going into 03. And a girlfriend of mine called, and she said, Carolyn, I'm going, Natalie wants to know how to read, and I got to go to work, and I need you to go with her to K-Field Literacy. She said, I will pick you up, and I want to take you there, and I want you to be a supporter to for Natalie. And I said, okay. And so, for some reason, my son said, Mama, I'll go with y'all. I said, okay. So the next morning, Bridget came, picked Derek and I up, and Billy was over at the time. And she took Natalie in, and Natalie said, can Carolyn come? And Billy said, sure, come right on in. And I went in there, and I sat on the sideline, and I watched how Billy nurtured and took care of Natalie.
Is this Billy Granger?
Billy.
She was the director at the time, right?
Yes. And I'm like, wow. And she tested Natalie, and Natalie was nervous. She was shaking. And she said, babe. And Billy, she didn't sit behind her desk. She didn't act like she was better than us. She came around and sat on her desk, face to face with Natalie. And she told her, she said, baby, you home. Everything is okay. And I'm watching this, and I'm like, really? You know, in my mind, I'm like, okay. And when she tested Billy, Billy tested Natalie and found out she was first grade. And before I could think twice, I said, can I be tested? She said, sure, baby, come along, sure. And of course, I knew I was second grade, but she said second grade. I said, okay. And I said, so she said, give me some time. Give me about a month. Because she said, I want the perfect people for you. She said, I'm going to pray over it, and I'll get back with you. Oh, a month felt like a year. I kept waiting. But I knew deep in my heart, Billy was going to come through. I was just excited. I mean, okay, Billy, you know. Yeah. And she did. She found them. She found our tutors. And when I first met the Barones, husband and wife, Natalie had the husband, I had the wife. And they are so sweet and kind. And I'm like, okay. And do you know I still have them today? 13 years later, they are still my tutor. But it wasn't easy.
How old were you when you were?
46.
Okay.
I was 46 when I went there, when I walked through those doors. And there are times I would go home and cry. And I would go back the next day. And I would go home. Because, see, when you can't read, you really can't write. What are you going to write? And I couldn't write. And I couldn't read. And I didn't want to write. I wanted to read. Because I really wanted to read the Bible. I have that Bible. And I wanted to read it, but my teacher was saying, no, we got to write too. I'm like, write what? She said, what you have read. Like, okay. So when she brought me the tablet and pencil, I couldn't tell her no, because she went to Walmart and she bought them. And I thanked her for them, and I said, okay. And started off with the alphabets. And when we got to, it was a word that I used to use a lot, but I never was introduced to that word I did not know how that word looked. I did not know how many letters was in that word until one day she was at the bulletin board and she was writing, and she wrote that word and she pronounced that word, and it was like, my God, like an old friend came home. And I'm like, I started smiling. And she said, what's wrong? Of course, tears started coming to my eyes. She said, what's wrong? I said something. I said, no. I said, pronounce that word again. And she said, read? I said, yes, read. Because I constantly used to tell myself, I want to read. I want to know how to read within myself. But I wouldn't tell nobody else. But I didn't know how read was spelled. I didn't know how it looked. I couldn't point it out to you, but when she wrote it, I told her, that's an old friend came home. And she said, well, 46 years old, I'm quite sure she did come home. And we started laughing together. She started crying with me. But yes.
So tell us about, you know, your journey to learning how to read before you, at the age of 46, kind of took leap. How
when I
was it difficult finding a job? And
listen, when I had when I got that diploma, I was home, and I didn't know where I was going to go. I mean, you know, kids was going to college that fall, and Mama said, well, why don't you go to Pearl, your older sister? Because she, you know, can use help with her kids at this moment. So I went to Rochester. And I didn't know how to read, but if you show me what to do, I could do it. And back then, it wasn't nothing like it is now. And besides, you went to the North and you from the South, they quick to hire you because Southern people work. And they would keep telling us, well, Northern people, they're lazy, they don't want to work. But if you from the South, they would hire you. And it was like verbal, so it really wasn't paperwork, you know, only to sign your name. And that, I didn't have a problem. But when I came back 8 years later, that's when it's like I stepped out into one world, into another one, because computers and everything, I mean, you know. And that's when I had my problems. I was 28 years old, and I got married, and I had a son. And when, you know, go to the doctors and they would give you books and pamphlets about pregnancy, read up on it. I couldn't read, but I had to fake it. And I did tell my husband.
That was what I was going to ask you. Did your husband know?
No, he did not know. When I felt that he got close, I would do something to start an argument and he would walk away. And it really hurt me. It hurted me hurting him, but I didn't want him to look down on me. For some reason, I felt that he would take my son away because I couldn't read or he figured I couldn't take care of him. And I used to pray that Derek would never get sick because I would have to take him to the doctor. And if the nurse just give me the prescription, I'm lost, and I wouldn't tell them, and I would, you know, take the prescription to the pharmacy hoping that they would tell me how much to give him. Sometimes they would, sometimes they wouldn't, so I had a hard time with that. I mean, I wrestled with that. It was a secret that I had kept, which I lost my marriage.
Do you contribute it to the illiteracy?
Well, yes, they have brought me a long way. Because when Derek, before I came here.
When did you meet your husband? How old were you?
I was 28 years old.
Okay.
And I was in Florence, South Carolina. And then we left there and went to Charlotte. And he was doing construction, engineer with lighting, electricity. So finance on that part was good, but it still didn't help me. And when I lost him, I became a single mother.
How old was your son when you became a single mother?
Derek was 2, going on 2. And I came back to my sister for a while, but I couldn't live there. So I went back to Charlotte. And I knew eventually he was going to go to school. And I still had this problem. And I was working with one of my girlfriends because she had a business. So that was a problem, but it still was a problem because I still didn't know how to read. And then Derek started going 2, 3, 5, 6 years old. And I'm like, okay, Carolyn, your baby's getting ready to go to school. How are you going to help him? And that's when the problem really started, when my child was getting ready to go to school. And when he was placed in a school, in a classroom with 30 kids and one teacher, and I knew he was going to get slipped through the cracks. And I refused it. And I said, what am I doing? And I would try to contact the teachers to talk to them. But I could understand. She had a young lady that just got out of college. And they gave her 30 kids in a small, cramped room. I know she was overwhelmed. So I had to go beyond her. Try to talk to the principal. They didn't want to do it. That's okay. So I pulled my son out of school. And I asked my neighbor across the street, could she keep him, you know, during the day? And I'll get him at night when I come from work. And when I found out that Derek couldn't read, because I prepared his classroom, his room, like a class. I had the alphabets, I had the numbers, I had everything. I took Derek as far as I could. At second grade, that was it. And I couldn't take him no more. And the school system just didn't care. It was overcrowded. It was frustrated. It was aggravated. And I understood that too. But that's still no excuse. That's my son. So what I did when I pulled him out, every morning at 8 o'clock, I would call downtown to the school board. And I said, I don't care how long it takes. And I'm going to call 8 o'clock every morning, tell them my name is Carolyn B. James. I lived on Seymour Drive. My son's name is Derek Earl James. I took him out of school, and he cannot read. And I did that almost 2 weeks. And then that Thursday, a school board member was knocking on my door, telling me that we're going to place him in a Magnum school because Magnum had just came out. And they had like a waiting list and raffle tickets and all that. And I knew I wasn't in the area for none of that. I knew I wasn't going to get that. But I needed help. My son was remembering the words, but to spot them and to know them, he didn't. And I couldn't afford that. I refused Derek Randall's shackles. Because I still had them on. And he was not going to wear them. No. No, he wasn't. And they placed him in a Magnum school. And at the end of that school term, he could read. And I told him I didn't mind if you put him back in regular school. But definitely going to have to know how to read. But they said, no, once he goes to a magnet school, he'll go to until he graduates. So I was happy for that. I mean, Jesus, I was happy. It was like someone gave me $1 million for him, because I knew he was going to make it. I knew he was going to be fine. And at that moment, that's all that was matter to me.
What would you say your proudest moment as a parent was?
Oh, when my son finally told me that he knew I couldn't read. And he told me, it's okay, Mom. And you know why it's okay? Because you fought for me to make sure I know how to read. Yes. That was my proud moment. Because I thought when he found out, he would look down on me, but he said, no, Mom, I'm proud of you because you fought for me.
If you could have had any other profession, what would it have been?
A writer. Because when I was going to elementary, junior high, senior high school, I would always visit the libraries. And there was tons of books, and I would rub my hand over them. And I used to wonder what was in them. Where could you go, or can you go places? Or, I mean, my books in school, I had a book bag, and I would take my books home every day. And I would take care of them, and I would take them back to school. And at the end of the year, I would say goodbye to them and give them back. So I always wanted to know. When I was in third grade, there was one teacher, and 10 minutes before she would close her class down, she would read to us. And that's where I got my vision. It was this race car story. She was reading to us, and she would tell us how the engine would roar, and the wheels would squeal. And when she was reading, I was right there at the finish line, waiting for checkers to come through, you know? And I never forgot that. And I tried to visit the library every day when I was in school at one period. When kids was outside playing, I would sneak to the library and just walk through there and just feel the books.
Do you visit our New Hanover County libraries?
Yes. Yes, when I first came here, yes. And then K-Field Literacy have one now, so I just go sit among the books. And
then,
just,
of course, the Senior Resource Center has a
I come
library.
See it too, yes.
Good. Very nice. And you're so young that, you know, your dreams of being a writer, you can still write that book. You can still be a writer and write even your story.
Well, to be truthful, I doubt if I would write my story, but I love to just like last week, I was talking to a friend, and I end up writing a little paragraph about Mr. Wall and where I lived because World War II, and I kind of like, well, I wrote about true story too. But at this moment, they're kind of sad. Mm. So my story would be a little too sad. I'm not ready to tell that side. I like fiction, some nonfiction, but all depends, you know? I like make-believe. Because when I was little, I placed myself in a make-believe world. Mm. With the dolls, the Barbie dolls, the dogs, the cats. I mean, you know, I went, my mama told me, She said, every time I get sad, I would go into a cocoon. And I would stay there for days. I would do my work. I would listen to what people say. But lack of communication, I didn't have. And my brothers and sisters, well, Mama, why Carolyn not talking? Leave her alone. That's all she would tell, leave her alone. So I was in my cocoon. And I had my world. And my world had no sadness, no anger, no bitter. So I stayed there. So that's why if I would write, I would give kids something good to think about, or even some place to go beyond this world.
But you have that ability now to write it down.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't even know where to start. I wouldn't know.
I can imagine the answer to this question, but what is your biggest life-changing event?
Year before last, when I reached the 12th grade level.
Good job.
I'm like, wow. When Yasmin Thompson told me, she said, you are on a 12th grade level.
And that's at the age of 59?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Very nice. Very nice. What is the one thing you want people to remember about you?
Well, really, I don't want them to remember me. I just want them to remember the voice crying in the wilderness. Not me. I'm just Carolyn B. King. Nothing super, nothing big. Mostly I want them to remember the voice.
What hobbies or jobs do you have today?
I still do a little bit of sewing. I'm quilting. But my joy is working with foster grandparents. And I call them my little people. Making sure that they have a fresh start. And let them know that reading is not a punish. It's a joy. Comprehending what you've read is an honor. Striving to do better is a privilege. I just want them to know.
So you are a foster grandparent volunteer with the Senior Resource Center. How did you hear about the foster grandparent program?
Well, I volunteered at Village of Greenfield for 7 years. Just up in it, and Ms. Nixon would say, well, Carolyn, you'd be here every day. You'd be here every afternoon. Why would you become a foster grandparent? I said, no, not really. I guess I didn't want it to be a job, because I wasn't looking for a job. I was looking for joy. And being up there with those little kids, I didn't want anything to change, you know? And when I turned 55, I told them no. I turned 56, I said no. She said, okay, Carla, this is last year I'm asking you. I said, okay. So I think I was 57 when I became one. And nothing haven't changed. They haven't changed. I still have my little people up there.
So you volunteer, your station is at the Village at Greenfield.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that's an after school program.
Yes.
And about how many children do you mentor that you work with?
Well, I have two now. Normally I would have three. And the sad thing about that is when the parents, when they move in, after a year or two, they move out. But the good thing about that, we have more people keep moving in with kids. So I'm meeting a lot of new faces. A couple of years ago at K-Field Literacy, I was speaking about little people. And one lady, she heard, and next thing I know, about 4 months later, I got like 500 books for the little people because I wanted to, I want each child to have a library, something I didn't have at home. And it doesn't have to be a wall-to-wall library. 10 books can be a library. And so I was like, asking Jasmine and the others, like, when y'all get books, you know, children books, would y'all let me know? So I would take them, and up at the center, I would give the kids 10, sometimes 15 books to take home. I remember one, it was a little girl. I mean, I was so thrilled. I was doing this, I was giving books. And one little girl, I had her 10 little books in a bag. And I said, guess what? I said, Miss Carolyn is going to give you these books and you're going to take them home. And I was looking down at her and she was looking straight to me. And I said, here, take the book. And she wouldn't take them. And I stood there and I said, then I got on her level. And I sat down and I said, why you want to take the book? She still wouldn't say nothing. She looked right at me. I said, okay. I said, can we finish this conversation later on? She still wouldn't say nothing. So I said, okay, go play. So she played. And her mother came. And I talked to her. And I told her what took place. She said that she's scared if she take them, someone will take them away. I'm like, why? She said, because like in school, teacher takes you to the library, you get the book, you keep them a week, you take them back. Well, when her brother would read or her mother would read to her, she's a dreamer. And she slept with the books. Or should I say the book slept with her. And it was time for them to go back. She didn't want them to go. And so they would be late. And then she couldn't get any more books for a week. And it went like that for a couple of times to the point that she rejected. She just pulled back. And she said, well, I used to take her to the library downtown. She said, but you know how the bus schedule and the fare, and she would hide the books. And by the time she got the books back to the library, she had like $2, $3, $4, so it was costly. So she said, that didn't help. I said, no, it didn't. It made her go in a cocoon. She said, yeah, something like that. She said, she trusts nobody now when it comes with a book. I said, well, nobody's not going to take these. So I gave them to the mother, and she took them home. And they moved. And I often wonder what happened. I know the books went with them, that's for sure. But I am praying that she is reading and she is dreaming. I am praying that she is traveling all over the world with those books. I really am. I know she is. Because that's what keeps me going, that little girl. And I know she is. I know she's going to be anything she wants to be in this world. Because she allowed her mind to take her away. And I know it. There's no doubt in my mind. Wherever she's living today in her family, she is going to make it.
Did you ever imagine at 60 years old, you would be where you are and now teaching and mentoring children how to read and how to write?
No, when I went to K-Field Literacy, I was 46 years old. In the first 5 years, I was real hard on myself. My teacher, she'll tell you now, I'm still hard on myself. I had to play catch up, and I still haven't caught up.
What keeps you so young? What keeps you going?
The little people, the little ones, because I was in the second grade when my world was turned upside down. And I wish that no child could go through that. I wish that all the children could read and feel confidence and feel good about themselves and don't be mean and upset and mad because they can't, but yet be teased about it, be picked on. It's the little people.
So I know you've been a foster grandparent volunteer for about 3 years or so. Yes. Mm-hmm. What does the Senior Resource Center mean to you?
Oh, hope. It's hope. It's hope.
And what do you look forward to as you continue to age and get older?
Oh, every day when I go up to the center, no matter if they're kindergarten, no matter if they're in the ninth grade, I wait to hear them make me laugh. Because they always got something funny to say or tell Miss Carolyn or show me their report card or say, look, my spelling words, I got an A. You know, I mean, the excitement on their face. That's my pay.
And also knowing that you are making a difference.
Well, they do, really, I don't see myself as that. I'm just, I tell them, you know, they say, well, Miss Carolyn, you? I said, no, baby, it's you. I just give you a little push, that's all, you know. But really, they're doing it because you can tell when a child want to know how to read. You can tell when a child does not want to be different from everybody else. It shows all over their face. And when you just smile and say, oh, can you read to me? And they say, well, you're not going to read to me? I said, no, baby. I said, I'm tired. It's the end of the day and I'm weary. Can you just take me to? Let's go see what Dr. Seuss is talking about. Let's see where he's going to take us today. So we're going to travel? I said, yes, we're going to travel. And when they start reading, and when we finish the book, and if we don't finish it that day, I put it aside, and then they go get it, because I showed them where I put it, and they get it. And they say, we're going to travel today? I said, yes, we are going to travel today. Listen, I get paid every time I go up there. I laugh with them. I smile with them. And they see me, see you, Miss Carolyn, tomorrow. I say, y'all have a blessed day. I have accomplished all I wanted to accomplish. When I see the smile on their faces, I do.
Well, Carolyn, I want to thank you for your time, not only today, but your time that you spend as a volunteer, giving back to our community and our children. You know, your story is incredible, and it's just amazing that, you know, the hope that someone who may be illiterate and not know how to read later in life, you mm-hmm. still have that hope, and you
oh,
can
yes.
learn. There's a lot of living to do.
Oh, yes.
So I thank you for sharing that.
Okay. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thank you.
To learn more about the New Hanover County Senior Resource Center, visit our website at src.nhcgov.com or call 910-798-6400.